Good evening and welcome. I'm Kelly Richards, CEO of the All Access Group and the host of All Access Radio. I've spent over 20 years creating innovative alliances in the digital media industry and driving the convergence of music, entertainment, and technology between major content companies, technology companies, and established musicians and celebrities. Tonight's guest on the show is Linda Ronstadt. Linda began her legendary career in the mid-60s with the folk rock group The Stone Ponies, and by the end of the 70s, she'd become the top-selling female vocalist of that decade. Widely referred to as the Queen of Rock, Linda has earned 11 Grammys, released numerous gold, platinum, and multi-platinum records, and lent her voice to over 120 albums. Over the years, she's collaborated with such diverse artists as Billy Eckstine, Frank Zappa, Philip Glass, Dolly Parton, Neil Young, Johnny Cash, Aaron Neville, and Nelson Riddle, among many others. Christopher Loudon of Jazz Times has hailed Linda as a chameleon who can blend into any background yet remain boldly distinctive. And her autobiography entitled Simple Dreams, a musical memoir, was released earlier this year in September of 2013 and reached the top 10 on the New York Times bestseller list in its first week on the market. Welcome to the show, Linda.
Thank you so much.
It's really great to have you. Before we move into the bulk of our conversation, I would like it if you could start off by sharing with our listeners what truly motivates you in terms of your passions, both on a personal and professional front.
Well, I don't know, really, whatever it takes to get through that particular day. I mean, when I was still singing, you know, it was whatever music I was studying at the time, whatever just thrilled me and that I just had to learn or I was going to die. I'd wake up,
sure.
You know, David Lindley, who's my cousin and a wonderful, wonderful musician, said to me one time, you have to sing the things you love, otherwise they'll keep you up at night. And he was right, you know, and there are things that still keep me awake that I never got around to that I tried my best, but I just couldn't get around to everything in my life.
Well, you know, you packed an awful lot in to this point, that's for sure, especially during your singing career, and we're all the better for it. You know, Linda, you were raised on a ranch in Arizona, and I guess I'd like to start sort of biographically.
Well, I was raised on the last 10 acres of my grandfather's cattle ranch, which was no longer a working ranch at that time. I mean, we had horses and chickens and, you know, stuff like that, but we weren't raising in the cattle business anymore.
Understood. And, you know, you certainly had some interesting experiences growing up in your family. I loved your autobiography, your memoir, and learned a lot that I never would have known. I don't think a lot of people realize about your upbringing and the kinds of things that influenced you musically growing up. Would you care to share a little bit about that side of things?
Well, living so close to the border as I did, and coming from a Mexican family, you know, of course there was a ton of Mexican music, and that had the most impact both on my singing style and on my love of beautiful melodies and rich lyrics, because the Mexicans write, you know, next to the Irish, I think they write the most beautiful melodies I've ever heard. And Mexico has a very, very rich tradition of poetry. The Aztecs thought that poetry was the most important thing you could have in terms of, it was indispensable in terms of expressing philosophical ideas or political ideas or intellectual ideas. You had to have poetry. They called it a scattering of jades, jade being the thing they valued even more than gold.
Right.
And so I've always been very sensitive to beautiful lyrics, but the shapes of their melodies are just extraordinarily beautiful. And when I was, you know, growing up, I thought they were wonderful. And when I started singing pop music, there was always a little something nagging at my shoulder saying, you know, the stuff you sang as a child is better than some of this stuff.
So, you know,
I always wanted to sing it. It just, I couldn't get a lot of cooperation with the record company until I had, you know, enough power to just tell them, I'm going to do this no matter what. And they were great about it when they realized that I'd made up my mind. They did what they could to help me.
And we're going to get to that a little bit later, because what I loved about that is when you did take the reins and insist on the creative direction of what you wanted to do next, it was always commercially successful, at least many times it was.
It was indeed, and I was also the most surprised of anybody.
Yeah.
Because
so
that wasn't what I was thinking about at the time. You know, at the time I was just thinking about, if I don't do this, I'm going to die.
Well, no, I get that, and I think a lot of artists feel that way, but you really had the gumption to just make it happen, and you did that repeatedly on multiple junctures, and it's really quite admirable. Well, let's go back to a little bit more towards the beginning, and we'll get to some of those junctures during our conversation, Linda. You know, you were only 18 when you started singing with the Stone Ponies, and only 23 when you released your first album as a solo artist, which is, you know, hand-sewn, homegrown, which is now recognized as the first alternative country rock album ever released by a female singer. So I'd love to hear what inspired you in those early years while you were writing this album and what it was like to be labeled a pioneer so early in your career.
Well, again, you know, it's just singing with the Stone Ponies. I mean, when I was growing up with my family in Tucson, I was a harmony singer. You know, we sang, we had a little group, my sister and my brother and I. And, you know, we'd take turns singing leads, but we sang a lot of harmonies, and that's what I was used to doing. In the Stone Ponies, Bobby Kimmel wrote most of the songs that we did, so he sang a lot of the leads, and I was a harmony singer. I had some solos myself, but I wasn't experienced as a solo artist when I went off on my own. The record company was rather insistent that I do so. So I went back to the songs that I learned, you know, sitting around my house in Tucson, and a lot of them were country songs that I could handle on the guitar. They had three chords. You know, it's not easier to play a three-chord song, but it was possible.
Sure.
You know, it's almost like the simpler it is, the harder it is to execute it well. But at least I could handle those three chords. So that's what I learned. You know, I had myself to sit around with in the living room and my own guitar, so I had to sort of work up what I could handle on the guitar.
Now,
so country rock became an obvious thing.
Sure, sure. Other things about what was going on in those early years, obviously Carole King, Carly Simon, Joni Mitchell were, you know, right in there with you. And
right in there, my God, I would say, you know, they were absolute pioneers and, you know, achieving huge, you know, they were the groundbreakers. I mean, Joni Mitchell particularly, what a brilliant, brilliant writer. But, you know, they wrote their own world. I mean, Carole, you know, who's such a good songwriter and just writes one high quality, you know, highly resonant song after another, wrote songs that other people could cover more. Joni Mitchell, it's hard to cover one of her songs. Carly, the same. Not quite, but, you know, she writes stuff that she would record and would be part of her world.
Mm-hmm.
So those songwriters' material weren't really accessible to me in a lot of ways. I mean, being not a songwriter, particularly myself, those singer-songwriters would keep their material for themselves, and then you'd have to wait till they recorded it before you, and then you didn't want to cover it because they sang it so well.
You know? Right. Now, what's interesting about...
I mean, you can't sing better than, than Carly Simon on You're So Vain. You can't sing better than Joni Mitchell on anything she's ever sung, you know. It was kind of like that.
On the other hand, I could clearly hear you singing, maybe it's my A&R background, songs like Nobody Does It Better. You know, I could hear you sing that song.
Oh, yeah, I probably could have, but why bother? Because Carly had such a huge hit with it, you know. I would have had to wait for a decent interval, like 7 or 8 years for it to go by. By that time, I'd be 100, you know,
yeah.
So...
And of course, when you started touring on your own in the early 70s, you were among one of those only handful of women on the touring circuit. Can you talk a little bit about the challenges of being a strong female in a male-dominated industry at that time and how you think things
have
changed?
Well, it's always a touchy thing. You always kind of hope they don't notice that you're female, you know. But I'll tell you a little secret about the music world. Musicians like what grooves. You know, if you don't screw up the groove, they don't care. You don't care if you're a giraffe. You know, or a goat, or a camel, or,
yeah.
You know, a transsexual. They don't care. They
yeah.
want you to, if you're a good player and you can keep up with the beat, you can, you know, not bring them down, they like it. And I surrounded myself consistently with musicians who were way better than I was, so I always ran the risk of them thinking that I was just hopelessly bringing down the tone of the room, but I learned that way, you know.
Yeah,
it's always been important
to
me to be I like everybody else in the room to be smarter than I am, and I like everybody that's playing music in the room with me to be better than I am, and that's how you pull yourself up, you know, that's how you learn.
I think it's easier for you to say that from your lens. I would argue that many times you probably were among the strongest musicians in the room, but I take your point. And in fact, our listeners may not realize, Linda, that many of them don't realize, perhaps, that the Eagles were originally your backup band. By example.
Well, you know, they were just great guys. They were in the area, and I was looking to put together a compatible bunch of musicians to play with me on a tour. And, you know, fortunately introduced Don Henley to Glenn Frey and then both of them to Bernie Ledden. And then John Boylan, who was my manager, introduced them to Randy Meisner, who became their bass player. So, you know, I had work, and they had time on their hands to while away while they were looking to get a record deal and get their first album recorded, and hopefully that it would be a hit, which, of course, it was a huge smash, and I was sure it would be after I heard them playing the songs they had all written together. But, you know, it was their talent that made them. It didn't really have that much to do with me.
Oh,
I had enough sense.
I don't know.
To see
you
they were good
there.
Players.
You played a key role in helping to bring Glenn and Don together back in that time. And
well, it was serendipitous. You know, it was a win-win situation.
Yeah, and of course, are you surprised all these decades later at how successful they've become?
No, I'm not, because sitting in my living room, I used to live with J.D. Souther, and I remember one day we went, J.D. and I went to the movies because our house was so small, they needed a place to rehearse, and there wasn't room for everybody to be sitting in there. We went out to the movies to give them some privacy to get their stuff together. And we came back, and they were playing Witchy Woman, you know, it was a four-part harmony arrangement of Witchy Woman that Bernie had written with Don Henley. And I just thought it was amazing. You know, their voices were beautiful. They had four strong voices. And
yeah.
They were four strong musicians. And they were just sitting in that. It was a very nice resonant room that sounded good. And they'd been sitting in there for hours working. And, you know, you tune your voices to the room. You tune your guitars to the room. You get it so it sounds really good in that room. It's never going to sound that good ever again on a record or in a concert hall or anything.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to sound the very best when it's first born in a sympathetic setting, you know, like that. And we walked in the door, and they were playing Witchy Woman, and it just blew me away. I went, this band is going to be such a huge hit.
Yeah.
And I had no doubt at all.
And you were
and of
right
course,
on
J.D. became the extra eagle. He was one of their main, he and Jackson Browne and Jack Temption became the other three eagles in terms of writing, you know.
Right, and all of these guys did something, and we go back to Carol, Carly, and Joni. All these people were known as songwriters.
Right.
Now, you know, you and I both realize at this point that, and I don't think a lot of people understand this either, that if you're not the songwriter, later in your career, you miss out on a boatload of royalties. Is that something?
Well, there's that. But, you know, I never did music for money, but I suppose if I had any sense, I would have written a song and put it on at least every album that I recorded. But I always wanted to just do the best songs, and I'd write a song every once in a while, but J.D. would come up with a better song, or Jackson would come up with a better song, or Eric Kaz would come up with a better song, and I thought, I think I'll just record the best songs.
Yeah, yeah.
So
over
my career, I recorded two of my songs, and they've both gotten covers.
Yeah.
So, you know, I was fortunate for that, but a writer was not, that's not what I was, that wasn't particularly my gift.
Yeah, and I understand that, but I think from a business perspective, I don't think people realize that most of the money that artists make over time comes from having been the songwriter and cashing those royalty checks.
Oh, yeah, publishing is huge. That's way more money than just being the singer.
I can recall introducing backstage in an award show I was the producer of, Debbie Gibson, to Taylor Swift as Taylor was just getting started. And I said to Debbie, please explain to Taylor why it's so important to keep her publishing. And I
had to
watch that happen backstage, you know. Because
good, yes, very important, because they'll get it away from you, and then you're sorry, and you don't get paid a cent, you know, for things that
yeah.
you sweated and slaved over.
Yeah, fair
she's
enough.
She's darling Taylor Swift. I think she's good.
Yeah, well, she's got her whole career ahead of her yet, you know.
Absolutely.
Now, you've always been a legend, Linda, but the 70s, obviously, were when you really exploded on the scene, and when you started topping the charts with albums like Heart Like a Wheel and Simple Dreams and Living in the USA. And that's when you earned this reputation as the queen of rock and even the first lady of rock. And you ultimately became the highest paid woman in rock. So can you talk a bit
about
how you...
Well, I don't know. I mean, highest paid when? I don't know when.
Okay,
exactly.
Well, maybe
that's
a bit of an exaggeration. But, you know, you've been very successful. And I wonder if you could share a little bit about how you dealt with the pressures of all that success, particularly early in your career.
Well, you know, there was a lot of touring, and touring is hard on your life. It's hard to maintain relationships, and it's hard to have a sense of, you know, an integrated reality into the culture where you are, or the neighborhood, or it's, you know, whatever you saw, whatever you have, you always saw it better in the last city, or, you know, like you go, oh, I saw better architecture in Paris, and I saw better food, I had better food in Mexico, and I, you know, really liked the way the stars looked in Nigeria, and you know, it's
yeah.
that kind of thing.
Yeah.
You start liking everything else and you're wishing you were someplace else. And that's hard. I had to just sort of confront myself with it a little bit and, get, you know, tell myself to wise up a little bit. But otherwise, you know, and it was a lot of pressure to travel because if you're not touring, you're not getting, it's a you have a symbiotic relationship with the audience. You don't pander to the audience, but by performing in front of live audiences, you get a sense of what is going to resonate with them, and you're not living in a vacuum, in a creative vacuum, you know.
Yeah.
So it's important to do that so that you see what happens, and then you try to do your very best to tell your most honest story, your most truthful story, and see what shakes the audience.
Can you remember when you first heard a song of yours on the radio and what that was like?
Well, let's see. Yeah, that would have been different drum. That was a day when we were on our way to a meeting at the record company, and we were driving in the car that belonged to Bobby Kimmel. It was an old Dodge, I think. And it was in very bad repair, and something happened. The engine froze, and it made this horrible scream of metal straining on metal, you know, that's just locked, and it's just barely slipping. It was a horrible sound. I've never heard a car make a sound like that. It was just a howling death cry. And, I mean, it was turning heads in the street. So we had to get out and push it finally. We pushed it into a gas station about a half a block away. And, they pulled up the hood and they said, oh, no help for this car. It's never going to run again. You know, it's just got a car to go to the junkyard. And we were very totally dejected because you can't survive without a car in Los Angeles.
No.
And it had all of our instruments, you know, Bobby's huge double bass and our guitars and us. And so, anyway, from the back of the gas station, I could hear there was like a little beep that was for the news, and then a jingle for KRLA, which was one of the big stations in LA at the time. And we knew that they were playing our record on the station, and it was like a regional breakout hit in San Francisco. But we hadn't heard it on the LA stations, and we knew that if they played it on one of the big LA stations, it was going to be a national hit. And that it was that moment that we knew we were going to have a national hit. But we didn't have any money, and we didn't have any car. We were stranded in West L.A.
Wow, wow. And, of course, Different Drum was written by Mike Nesmith of the Monkees.
He made a lot of money. And the Stone Ponies, after another album, I think they made one more record with me. And then they were taken off the books. So they were paid, and deservedly so, you know, they were paid royalties for those songs, for that song. But I didn't make any money because I stayed under contract and had to pay the bills of the Stone Ponies records that didn't sell, you know, that Different Drum was paying the bills for. So.
Right.
It was another 10 years of pretty grinding poverty before I ever made any money.
See, I think people just outside the industry just don't understand that. They can't understand how somebody that successful, you know, this, and we've seen it time and again. You know, you name any 10 artists.
I could pay the rent, but my rent was $300 a month, you know.
Yeah. Yeah,
and I had, you know, spending money, but not a lot. And I had, you know, bought my clothes at the thrift store, so it wasn't a big deal. In those days, we were hippies. We just wore whatever. We wore jeans and whatever we could find to put on the top.
Yeah, but it is a little bit of an injustice looking backwards. You know, it's just the way it works.
I don't know. I mean, you know, the record company shells out the money to start with. I'm sure they have all kinds of ways to steal it from you, or they did in those days. I don't really know.
Yeah.
But I eventually got paid, you know, so it works out.
Now,
there ought to be gatekeepers, I think. I'd like to see a return of the way the old record companies were, so that there would just be some gatekeepers for quality control, but everybody gets paid much more fairly would be good. But
frankly, I've spent a good chunk of my career trying to correct and right some of those wrongs, Linda. So, you know,
well, bless your heart.
I mean, a little
it
late party in some cases, but you know, I started a company with Todd Rundgren in the mid '90s, and we were the first to come up with this concept of artists going direct to their fans based on new technologies, and you know, that turned the whole machine around.
Yeah, but it brought about the collapse of the
Pretty much. It was a part of the chip that brought the wall down, you know, the Napster.
Because now it's so hard for anybody to collect, you know, these huge servers are broadcasting all this information, and they upload it for free, and nobody gets paid, but they get paid when you buy it from them. They get paid.
Yeah, actually, it's probably a longer conversation that we should have about all the different ways that artists that do have a brand and a following can make good money in the digital age. It's a whole conversation.
Jerry Lanier wrote a really good book called Who Owns the Future that talks, you know, that uses the record business as, you know, example of what can happen where the internet can deliver mass hyper unemployment. It's a scary scenario.
Yeah, but flip side of it is there's so many ways to monetize your brand as an artist that you never would have had before. So,
well, I haven't figured out any of them.
I'm more than happy to
send
have a conversation
a list.
on that. Truly, I mean, we're here in the Bay Area together. We'll find a way to get together and make that happen. But I want to go back to the fact that you've had an amazing number of collaborations throughout your career, Linda, so many. Do a couple stand out? We talked about J.D. Souther, the Eagles, a little bit. I know you're very, very fond of your relationship with Emmylou Harris and Dolly. Anything you'd like to share about some of your favorite collaborations?
Well, Mariachi Vargas, you know, when I finally got, I had heard them ever since I was a child. They started out at the turn of the 20th century, you know, as a wonderful ranchera mariachi, and I'd always listen to them. They had backed Lola Beltran and my heroes, and when I got a chance to play with them, that was really kind of like the high point of my career. It was just a thrilling experience, and we got to tour together. We got to make two albums together, and then I eventually got to work with Mariachi Los Camperos from Los Angeles, who are just as good.
Mm-hmm.
And wonderful players, and they were, you know, the generosity of those guys, because I've heard that music since I was a little child, but it's fiendishly difficult to play and sing. You
yeah.
really got to know what you're doing, and they really helped me. They could have gone, who is this chick, you know, this Mexican-American chick, who does she think she is trying to sing traditional Mexican music? We own this field, we own this territory, and they could have been very jealous and protective. And just, you know, shine me on, but they didn't. They were incredibly generous, and they were incredibly helpful, and they sat down, they were patient, they taught me the rhythms, because it's just so hard to do. I could sing La 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 when I was little, but I couldn't do it up to a professional standard. That
right.
took a lot of woodshedding.
Yeah, well, this is a tribute to your being as eclectic as you've been, and having had a passion of wanting to move in these different directions that your muse was driving you towards, effectively. And, you know, if we go to that 87 album, Canciones de mi Padre, you were really, truly exploring your musical heritage and your family roots. So,
well, it's such
you know,
an incredible singing style, and it gives you so much freedom and so much ability. And my voice is so much suited for that. You know, my voice is not suited for little short note songs, which are sort of tempo, you know, blah, 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 blah kind of songs without much melody that I was finding in rock and roll, which are great for somebody like Eric Clapton to take a big old screaming guitar solo over, but
right.
not so great for singers.
Right, right.
You know, and, not like the standards, you know, that offer incredible vocal possibilities or the Mexican stuff the most for me.
Well, and again, the album was a huge commercial success, so anybody who doubted the transition from going to a pop rock singer to, you know, another style had to have been quelled after that, because you proved that you could cross over like that. And I think
I have to blame the material, because the material was so good.
Yeah, well,
you know,
I don't know.
People don't realize that when they bring that into the world stage, other people like Vicky Carr and, another singer. Well, Nat King Cole also did Mexican songs. Wasn't Mexican himself, but loved the song so much, recognized that, you know, he sang the boleros, which are the jazz standards from that era, you know, just wonderful.
Yeah, but I want to give you credit for sort of helping to bridge that Latin gap as well, because it really was ahead of all the Tejana stuff with Selena that, you know, really busted things open and crossover. And, you know, you really were on the cusp of making that happen. The Latin audience is huge.
Right.
And I don't
think... Well, it is.
I don't even think you probably thought about that. You were just following
I didn't really. I just thought the songs were so good I had to sing them. And they suited my voice so well that, you know, that's what I wanted to do.
Look back, again, it's a tribute to, you know, you can't connect the dots till you look backwards. But it is kind of a tribute to your having created one additional juncture along your journey that made a big impact. I wanted to touch on some of the other eclectic choices that you made. Certainly your work with Nelson Riddle and the orchestra was something I don't think anybody would have expected, and that turned out to be a very important part of your career.
Well, I love to work with the orchestra. The orchestra brings colors out of your voice that you're not going to get when you know, there's a lot of cross resonances that happen,
mm-hmm.
and cross pollinations in sound. And also those songs were what I heard my father and my mother singing when I was growing up, and the records they brought home in the 50s, you know, Ella Fitzgerald and Billie Holiday and Frank Sinatra and Louis Armstrong. I mean, just fabulous, fabulous, wonderful June Christie, you know. And I listened to them by the hours, because where we lived it was really hot for 6 months of the year.
Sure.
You pretty much couldn't go outside.
Yeah, no
kidding.
And then
during the other 6 months of the year it was so cold you didn't dare. So Arizona is a equal opportunity, you know, so you can die of exposure any time of the year there,
yeah, no.
freeze or fry. So there was a lot of time to sit indoors and just listen to music and learn from it. And that's what I did. And those songs were so beautiful. Again, they offered such incredible a vocal expression for a vocalist. All kinds of colors you can have and sophisticated lyrics that, you know, deliver 19 levels of meaning. So it was something that kind of matched up with what I was reading. You know, I liked it a lot.
Got to be very powerful to sing in front of an orchestra.
Well, it's a wonderful experience because especially if you have a good arranger that knows how to work the orchestra so it only supports you and never gets in the way. Because there's so many tones in the orchestra can just trample over you if it's, you know, not in skilled hands.
Sure.
But Nelson
Riddle,
of course, was the best of that genre, and I was lucky to be able to work with him.
You surely were. And then we segue to your time on Broadway. And again, now it's a common thing for artists to cross over. Sting's mounting a new show next year. You know, we started with ABBA some years ago, but you were way out in front of all that.
I didn't write the show. I got to give Sting a little bit more credit if he's writing it. I didn't know about that, but I'm glad to hear that.
Right.
But I mean, I did something, you know, again that I took out of my childhood, Gilbert and Sullivan. We all sang it when I was little. My sister was in, you know, HMS Pinafore. She sang Buttercup. You know, everybody at that age, from that time, you know, if you'd been through school, has had an experience with something from Gilbert and Sullivan. It's the kind of thing you can't kill with a hammer. It's so sturdily well constructed.
Right. And, you know, in my work with Todd Rundgren, he had also written a show with Joseph Papp, which was
really
Beatles music called Up Against It before Joe died. And Todd also attributed a lot of his inspiration to Gilbert and Sullivan because, you're the same era, and you all grew up listening to that.
Right. It's just great stuff.
Yeah. So I think that, again, I just wanted to wrap up that whole part of your career about going in eclectic directions. And, of course, Todd's another example of someone who's done that, reinvented himself throughout his career. But in both cases, you guys followed your muse and your passions, and you let that drive what you did without regard to whether it was going to be a big commercial success or not. And I think that's profound.
Well, you know, I was part of it was lucky, you know, but you have to, your choices, the trick is your choices have to resonate with the public. It doesn't matter how passionate you are. If those choices don't resonate with the public, then you'll be out of luck. But I was lucky, and the public did like those things. I just always felt that if I liked, maybe it's narcissistic, but I just thought if I liked them so much, the public would have to because they were beautiful, and they were.
Yeah, to be sure. And another thing I wanted to touch on, Linda, is that no woman or man is an island, and you've had some people around you throughout your career. Your loyalty to them is incredibly admirable, and it certainly would include John Boyle, your manager, Janet
John Boylan,
Stark.
Yeah.
Boylan.
Well, Peter Asher was my manager through most of that. John Boylan is a record producer and a record company executive, and he was managed me for a while as a favor and produced some of my records, including one of my best ones, the last record that I made, I think, called Humming to Myself. But you know, he and I have also been just friends. You know,
yeah.
We like to read the same books. We're just, you know, we sort of have the same values. I like his wife and kids. So it's just a friendship that's lasted, and that's incredibly fortunate.
But I think you'll agree it's also pretty important to have people around your career that you can really trust, because that's not so
common.
Well,
Peter Asher, you know, was exactly that, an incredibly trustworthy person. I trusted his values and his taste and his intelligence and his sense of fairness.
Yeah.
Those things are really important, and those things are not negotiable.
And not least of which, he had been an artist himself, of course. It was Peter and Gordon and, you know.
Exactly, a substantial artist, and had such a varied career because he started out as an actor, and then he was in a boys' chorister, and then he was a huge pop star, and then he was the president of Apple Records, or head of A&R, I guess, for Apple Records.
Yeah,
helped run it. I mean, he had this incredible, and then he managed James Taylor and produced him, and he had done all these things before I ran into him.
Right. So he really was steeped in all facets of the industry, which really served you well, I think.
It really did. I mean, when I went to work, on Broadway, he knew all the ins and outs of theater etiquette, like who, you know, what you do with your dressing room when you're sharing, you know, how you have to keep all your stuff over on your end of the room, you know.
Yeah.
And how not to impose on other people and what the protocol is. It was very, very important.
Yeah, and then we go to somebody like a George Massenburg. I mean, I was a would-be record producer that was the wrong gender, so I've always admired George Massenburg's work, and you were fortunate to work with him on so many of your albums.
Yeah, he's brilliant. I mean, he invented a lot of, you know, so much state-of-the-art stuff that people take for granted every day in recording.
Exactly. And so you really have had the best of the best around you, and I don't know if you can just chalk that up to luck, but I think it's made a big difference.
Well, it helped me, that's for sure. Like I said, all working people are better than you are. They'll bootstrap you up.
Yeah, especially if you can trust them. And again, we come back to that being so important. Now, you just released your autobiography, your memoir, as we talked about it earlier in the introduction, Linda, Simple Dreams, a Musical Memoir. And I wonder how difficult it was, if it was, to try and sum up your life and career for the book.
And, you know, what I was listening to when I was little and how that gave way to the stuff that I wound up performing when I was older. And that made it easier. I mean, I don't have any experience writing. I'm a reader, so I have an idea of what a fluid sentence looks like. But and clarity is really important, and you know, so I could write a clear sentence, but I could write it about myself because I knew the story. If I had to write a book about, you know, comparing the economies of Argentina, Canada, United States, and South Africa, which is a book I'd love to read, I don't think I would know how to organize that and write it. I'd have a hard time.
Well, if you did something like that, you'd probably have to collaborate with somebody, you know.
Well, I think I'd have to let somebody else do it. But
yeah.
I know my own material of my own life because I lived it, so that was pretty easy, and I just went chronologically, and I said, well, you know, I was listening to this, and so I sang that. I was listening to this, so I sang that. And I always, and then I think, what happened next? What was in the living room? You know, who was playing what? You know, who was I hanging out with? What songs were they writing? And I could just figure it out.
And did you enjoy it?
I did. You know, it was fun to, sometimes it was painful, you know, sometimes I think back about what I was doing, especially the part time when I was really struggling and didn't know how to sing very well. I mean, then I just decided that what the story was I wasn't very good when I started, but I got better.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it didn't mean I became the greatest singer in the world, it just meant that I improved, and that's always a happy thing.
Yeah, no doubt about that.
So that gave me the courage to keep going.
Yeah. Well, now, one sad thing.
And it's
again,
always somebody better, you know, when you look around you.
Sure.
I mean, anybody that wants to be competitive in art, just forget about it because it won't get you anywhere. I mean, there's always Bonnie Raitt or Jennifer Warnes or God only knows who, you know, is going to sing me under the table. And I was always aware of that, but it just didn't matter. You just do the best you can that day and try to do your own, you know, do your own little thing the best you can.
Of course.
And that's what counts.
I think comparing yourself to others is kind of a recipe for disaster because there's just always things you're going to make up in your own mind that will pull you down.
Yeah, Dolly Parton, when she came to sing with the trio, she said, you know, you girls can sing this way. You can't out-unique me, and I can't out-shout you. And, you know, we just looked at each other. We're not competing. We're cooperating. I think women tend to go to a cooperative mode before men do anyway, you know. That's why I don't like these shows that are on TV, these reality shows. I've never seen. There's one real popular one that's on some Fox
channel.
Like
Idol or something, all of that.
American Idol, that's what it's called. I've never seen it.
Yeah.
But the way it was described to me, it just seemed like anti-art. You know, I just thought, what a destructive thing to put a bunch of singers together, or performers, and have them pitted against each other and try to cripple each other, you know?
Well, and that's on their side of the stage. And then there's the judges out in front that often slice and dice them, you know?
What would you do with somebody like Bob Dylan or Paul Simon or Randy Newman in a circumstance like that?
And can you imagine Bob Dylan performing in front of Simon Cowell? He would have been chopped to pieces.
Yeah, I don't know, you know, I don't know who those guys are, but I can't imagine in that kind of a format any of those really truly great artists surviving.
Right. Well, thank goodness they didn't have to worry about that back then.
Yeah.
Well, one sad note for our listeners is that Linda is no longer able to sing. You've been suffering from Parkinson's disease, as I understand it.
I do, indeed.
That is a travesty. But
well,
I'm sure
it's not fun,
you're adjusting. I'm sure you're adjusting. And so how are you spending your time these days?
Well, I spend a lot, even more time reading. And in terms of music, I spend my time with a group called the Sensonless. They're up here in Richmond. It's a little culture in a cultural center that teaches traditional Mexican music to kids.
Yeah.
Teaches music, dancing, and visual art. Just absolutely brilliant job they do teaching kids art. And they teach it to them for the best reasons. You know, they wind up with a performing group. The kids are really good. They come out of there. They really can play, sing, and dance. But that's not the purpose. It's they don't they don't learn it so that they can become famous or they can become performers professionally, although some of them do.
Mm-hmm.
But they learn it so that they can use art to help process their feelings, how to help them through a job of work, how to help them proclaim who they are and how they fit into their culture. You know, sing for
That's
a mate,
phenomenal.
All the things that people use music for, music and visual art for. And they, like I said, they do the best job I've ever seen with kids. And we're learning now how important the arts are in terms of helping kids with education. These kids go on to graduate from high school, lessening in teen pregnancy, less gang affiliation, more people graduating from college. You know, the percentage of these kids that graduate from this little program is huge.
And improve.
So that I do a lot of that.
Don't forget the improvement in the self-esteem. That's equally critical.
Oh, it's huge. I mean, you can just watch them develop year after year because they start when they're about 5 and they wind up, 16 years old and they're still there and loving it.
And that speaks to the TV show Glee, if you've ever watched that. Now, that is a productive show to have.
I've never seen it, but I never had a TV for 40 years.
Yeah, no. This is a show that is about high school teenagers singing in a choir. And frankly, every show they cover a certain artist's songs. They did Billy Joel last week. They've done the Beatles. They've done everybody. Probably
well,
going to cover
Billy Joel
your
writes great stuff for choruses. I'm a great believer in singing in parts. I just preach choirs. When people ask me about children's music educations, I say, start them up in a little choir. It doesn't cost anything.
Yeah,
start them
yeah.
when they're 5.
And I was
singing
in a choir,
when
and I
they're
it.
Third grade, get them singing rounds. You know, they'll
yeah.
learn how to sing harmonies that way.
And you learn how to collaborate and work with others in that way. You know,
yeah,
it's all
and make a conspiracy
thing.
To commit beauty.
Yeah, yeah, that's well said. And so this Glee show, you know what else it does, Linda, since you haven't seen it? It revives people's careers. It exposes your music to as an artist to a whole new generation of a whole new audience.
Oh, fantastic.
So, you know, at some point, we're happy to talk to John Boyle and see if we can't lobby to get them to cover Linda Ronstadt songs on one of the Glee episodes. Millions of people watch this, you know.
Well, but remember, I didn't write them, so...
It'll
be nice for Phil Everly or whoever, or Eric Kaz or whoever wrote the song. But it'll
nice
be fine.
To get
I'm
your,
in favor
your,
of it.
Yourself back in the public eye in that regard, though. So that may be something to look at. But now looking back at your tremendous career, Linda, what do you hope has been a legacy that you're leaving from the singing part of your career? What message do you think it's important for your fans to carry with them?
Well, I don't know. You know, I think Joseph Campbell said you follow your bliss. And when you do, doors open that where you didn't even know there were doors, you know. So
yeah.
Maybe that's what I say, follow your bliss.
Yeah. Sound advice.
The other thing, the other thing I always say to people that are starting out in music is I say, read everything you can read, see every art picture, go to every museum, go to plays, go to the ballet, go to every art movie you can, because every single experience that you have is like a clear-colored lens that goes over layer after layer after layer and enriches whatever it is you're doing. So every
mm-hmm.
book you read, every picture you see is going to affect every note you sing if you're a singer.
Right. Right. That's really important. I don't think a lot of people think about why that's so important, but all art is informed in some way or another by other art.
And that's what I'm saying. You know, people with a good liberal arts education that don't select a major, 3 years before they start college, do way better in business 5 or 6 years after they start
mm-hmm.
because they know how to think
yeah.
as opposed to just memorize how to do something, you know.
And they have more of a breadth of exposure to a lot of different
exactly.
History and art that really means something, frame of reference.
And if you don't go to college, you can always read. That's what I did. Just read
right.
everything, and especially classic literature. Now there's so many studies. There's been a scientific study that shows that people that read classic literature as opposed to classic literary fiction as opposed to popular fiction, that they become more, their emotional intelligence is higher, their ability to empathy, their interactive social skills are immediately better. Even if you read 12 minutes a day, they find that it improves those skills hugely.
Well, I'm a lifelong learner, and I try to encourage other people to be as well. I probably read a book a week or maybe even 2 books a week sometimes.
Me too. I love it.
Yeah. And I think it's important to keep your mind sharp and to be well-rounded and well-informed and, it's just critical.
Exactly.
So I want to congratulate you on your recent nomination for the 2014 induction into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I think that's probably overdue. How did that make you feel?
Well, I, having no television, I didn't know about the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. It was something that it was made an issue by other people than me. I don't care. You know, I never consider myself to be defined as a rock and roll singer, and I don't, you know, just, I mean, it was nice of them. Everybody likes their work to be recognized, but it just wasn't important. What was really important to me was the Latin Grammy that I won.
You know? Yes, yes, I bet that was.
And the Alma Award that I won. I mean, those things are really dear to my heart, and I love the fact that I was able to, you know, reconnect to my own culture in that way, and it gave me back who I was.
Well, and it brought your music to a whole new audience, that music to a whole new audience.
Yeah, that was a good thing. It brought me a new audience, too, which was nice.
Yeah, yeah, it was a win-win all around. Well, you know, Linda, I'm mindful of our time, and I want to thank you for making the time for us today. But before we wind down, I just want to ask, is there one project or collaboration that you've not yet started that you still dream about creating?
Well, I would love – there's two people I would love to have been able to record with, Little Joe from Little Joe y La Familia and David Hidalgo from Los Lobos. You know, I've sung with David. We actually were able to record one little thing, but my voice had already gone by then. If I had time and I were still singing, if I were still in my prime, I would follow Little Joe around for a year.
Hmm.
And just because he stands at the apex of what, or at the meeting place where, you know, standards, rancheras, rock and roll, all of that stuff, he can cover it all, and he covers it. There was an area where it all met about 1954, 1956. Those three kinds of music just had a collision that was wonderful, especially in L.A.
Mm-hmm.
And he really gets that, you know, in Texas also.
I
would just follow him around for a year and learn everything I could and then, you know, go make a record with him someplace.
Yeah,
and David Hidalgo, I mean, he's one of my favorite writers, favorite singers. He's just an incredible guitar player. He really has his own individual, unique sound. You know, there aren't very many people. There's Eric Clapton, there's Ry Cooder. You know, there's these guys that have this completely recognizable, unique sound, and David Hidalgo is one of them.
Sure.
So just getting to be in the room with him has always been an honor for me.
Yeah. Well, you know,
he works with the Sensual List too, and so is Ry Cooder, so is Taj Mahal, so is Jackson Brown. So, you know, it's just I get to work with these guys sometimes through the auspices of the Sensual List, and it's really fun.
Yeah. Well, you know, you fall into the same category as a lot of those guys too. You've got your own unique sound. You've brought so much pleasure to the world, to music lovers, and across these different styles and eclectic maneuvers. And I really honor you for following your vision and your muse as you've worked your way through all of that throughout your career.
Well, I tried.
Yeah,
I did my best. Sometimes it wasn't so good, but sometimes
it
was better.
I think you did a fabulous job. Give yourself more credit. And I really want to thank you, Linda. It's been such a pleasure talking with you tonight. I appreciate you making the time for us.
Well, same here.
And I hope that our paths will cross pretty soon. We're both in the Bay Area, and I'll see you about
it.
To make that happen. But I want to thank our listeners, as I always do, for joining us each week. We'll hear you all again next week on the next edition of All Access Radio. And this is Thanksgiving week, so I want to wish everybody, including you, Linda, a wonderful Thanksgiving.
Same to you, and thank you so much.
Yeah. Good night, everybody.